The Presonus AudioBox USB96 now comes in all black, and without a doubt it looks very cool. But the big question remains, how does it perform? Well, we're about to find out. Hey, Julian Kraus here, and this is the Presonus AudioBox USB96 in the 25-year anniversary edition. I want to point out that there are three versions of the AudioBox available. One with a blue and silver look, one has a black housing and silver knobs, and now you can get the anniversary edition, which is essentially all black. Aside from the looks, the three editions perform exactly the same, as they have the same internals. So in this video I'm going to check out the anniversary edition, but everything I say also applies to the other version as well. With that out of the way, let's check out the hardware. On the front you can find two XLR and TRS combo inputs to plug in microphones, instruments or line level devices. In the middle you got a button to toggle the phantom power for both XLR inputs. Further to the right, the interface has two knobs to control the gain for the inputs. Right next to the knobs you get an LED which indicates clipping. You got three more knobs, one to control the mix between the direct audio and the sound from your DAW, which I personally quite like to see on an audio interface, one more knob to control the headphone volume, and the last knob controls the main output on the back, which you can connect to studio monitors and the like. And there's also a power LED which lights up when the interface is plugged in. On the back you can find a USB type B connector, one MIDI input, a MIDI output, two balanced TRS outputs, and lastly a quarter inch headphone jack. Regarding the build quality, I have to say that the AudioBox feels very sturdy. The whole housing is made out of metal and especially the sides are some solid chunks of metal pieces. The knobs on the front of the interface feel pretty decent too. They are very solid, and even though the controls on the front are a bit cramped, they are still easy to operate. Now let's talk audio performance and start with the mic inputs. At the maximum gain, the frequency response looks like this, which to be honest is not that impressive. At 20Hz and 20,000Hz, the response is down by pretty much exactly 2 decibels. While this is less of an audible problem than you might think, it definitely shows that very low and very high frequencies are not recorded at the same amplitude as other frequencies in the audible range. As with many interfaces, the response improves when you set the gain to about half. At 20Hz the response is now down by about 1.5 dB, and at 20,000Hz the response is now much flatter. By the way, the sharp drop-off around 45 kHz is caused by the anti-aliasing filter, which is due to the maximum sample rate of 96 kHz. So if you're striving for a transparent recording with the AudioBox, it's best to use condenser mics because they use less gain, which will end up in a flatter frequency response. And spoiler, the recommendation to use condenser mics with the AudioBox is going to be a reoccurring theme throughout this review for several reasons. Now let's have a look at the distortion of the microphone input. As you can see, the distortion components are very low, around 90 to 100 decibels below the fundamental. That's very nice. What's not so nice though is the strong rise of preamp noise towards the lower frequencies. When I saw this, I was quite interested in the equivalent input noise, which results in a number which lets you directly compare the preamp noise between different devices. I wasn't expecting a perfect performance, but I was still surprised by the high EIN of -116.5 dBUA weighted. Here's how the AudioBox compares to other interfaces, and it's the worst performer by far. The big question is, how does this sound like? Well, listen for yourself. Now I'm speaking into a Shure SM7B, which is directly connected to the AudioBox USB96. The SM7B has a very low output level, and this brings out the noise of the preamp. Let me be quiet for a second for you to listen to the noise of this setup. I know, the SM7B is pretty much the worst case scenario in terms of preamp noise, but even with more sensitive dynamic microphones with the AudioBox, you will end up with a very audible amount of noise. And that's the second reason I cannot recommend using dynamic microphones with the AudioBox. By the way, with condenser mics you do not have this preamp noise problem, as they put out a much stronger signal, and then you're limited by the noise performance of your microphone and not the preamp in the interface. I know a few people will recommend a Cloudlifter or Fathead to battle the preamp noise of the AudioBox, and I have to say that the AudioBox is the perfect candidate to use with an inline preamp, as it reduces the preamp noise considerably. That said, the preamps on the AudioBox should have been lower noise to start with, so that you're not forced to spend even more money on a cloud header. To be honest, when I listened to the noise that the AudioBox produced with a dynamic mic, I first thought that I might have a defective device. That's why I got a second unit to confirm my measurements. And lo and behold, it was exactly the same. In fact, all the measurements I show in this video are verified with the second unit, and the measurements were always nearly identical. One more important point of a microphone input is the dynamic range. A high dynamic range allows you to leave yourself more headroom while recording, and this simultaneously keeps the noise to a minimum. I measured the dynamic range of the AudioBox and it comes in at 97.6 dBA. This is still okay for recordings like dialogue, but in more demanding scenarios with loud and quiet sounds, the dynamic range can become the limiting factor in terms of noise. If you want a third reason why you shouldn't use a dynamic microphone with the AudioBox, it would be the input impedance. To not change the sound of a microphone, the input impedance should be preferably as high as possible. Many interfaces have an input impedance of around 3000 ohms, which is okay, and 1000 ohms is what I would consider to be the tolerable minimum. And sadly, the AudioBox only comes in at around 650 ohms. This can have a noticeable effect on the sound of your dynamic microphone. So, all in all, it's a subpar performance of the microphone inputs. Let's move on to the line level input and see if it can restore my faith in this interface. Here's the frequency response of the line level input, and this already looks quite good. In the audible range, the response stays roughly within half a decibel. The harmonic distortion is also very low, with the second harmonic sitting at only 100 decibels below the fundamental. Aside from the distortion, there seems to be quite a bit of interference going on in the noise floor, and you can see a lot of spurious tones here. Though they are low enough so that in practice they shouldn't be audible. All in all, the THD plus N is about minus 85 dB, which is just okay, and to my surprise, the dynamic range of the line level input is actually worse than the mic input, coming in at only 89 decibels. One more thing I noticed is that even with the gain all the way to the minimum, the maximum input level is only 3 dBV. That's not even consumer line level, which is typically 6 dBV. Depending on how strong the line level is from the device you want to record, your input might be clipping even though the gain is all the way down. So, to be honest, I'm not impressed by the line level inputs either. But there is still hope. Let's have a look at the outputs and start with the main out on the back. Here you can see the frequency response, and this is more like the performance I'm looking for. At 20 Hz, the response is only down by about a decibel, which is arguably negligible. And the frequency response stays very flat, even above the human hearing range. The dynamic range comes in at 96 dB, which is about the level of your typical CD master, and the distortion is also well behaved at around 90 decibels below the fundamental. The only obvious thing that could be improved is the rising noise in the lower frequencies. Still, with that performance, the main output is arguably very usable. As in my previous review, I made multiple measurements of the headphone output and put the results into a table so you can directly compare them to other interfaces. Let's have a look at the frequency response, and here you can already see that the AudioBox has a pretty bad value, which is indicated by the red color. This gets a bit clearer when we have a look at the frequency response graph with a 32 ohm load attached. The lower frequencies fall off quite noticeably, which shows that there is a loss in bass with low impedance headphones. When you use higher impedance headphones, this problem goes away nearly completely, and now the AudioBox shows a decently flat response. The output impedance is surprisingly low, which is one of the things that the AudioBox does right. The noise of the headphone output with the gain all the way to the minimum or a normal listening level is okay, so as long as you're not using very high sensitive cans, you shouldn't hear any noise. With about 1.3 dB, the channel balance is also okay, meaning that regardless where you set your gain, the left and right side of your headphones will be equally loud. And the crosstalk figure is pretty good, which results in a nice stereo image. All in all, I have to call this a subpar performance of the headphone output. With low impedance headphones, the interface has quite a bit of power, but the linear and non-linear distortions can become audible. With high impedance headphones, the distortion is much lower, but there the interface lacks the power to drive these kinds of headphones. My recommendation is to stick to 80 or 150 ohms headphones to get enough power and low distortion with the audio box. And even then, the performance won't be perfect. So, what's my verdict? Well, I'm surprised by the performance of the Audiobox USB 96, and sadly, not in a good way. I know that PreSonus can build some quite nice audio interfaces, I've tested them before, so I'm really not sure why they designed the Audiobox like this. I get it, it's an entry-level interface, but that doesn't mean that the preamps should